Hello and welcome to the Monday, June 17th, 2024 edition of the Sands and its Storm Center's Stormcast. My name is Johannes Ulrich and today I'm recording from Jacksonville, Florida. Quick blog post from Didier this weekend about, well, a quick summary of the different tools that Didier has produced and how they're dealing with JSON. We, of course, had a couple blog posts in the past where Didier went over some of the JSON features. We had the JQ blog back on Friday, but this one just gives you a list of the different tools, which ones can actually accept JSON input and which ones will create JSON input. Now, when you say you're using JSON, you, of course, don't really say much because how the data is really organized and such still depends. Didier calls this MyJSON, which basically means that these tools are compatible with each other as far as how different fields, properties, and such are named and how the JSON is exactly formatted. Last week, I mentioned the Sleepy Pickle vulnerability and how this is really, you know, just yet another example of how Pickle files can actually be abused for code execution. If you wondered how this exactly worked, how deserialization vulnerabilities are being exploited in Python, Mark Baggett came out with a real great sort of video and associated challenge where you can experiment with these vulnerabilities yourself. A great little lesson, probably only takes you 15 minutes, maybe half an hour to sort of walk through it and really sort of brings home this very current risk to not just machine learning, but really other uses of Python. So it's not only a real good thing to know about, but if your boss asks what you're doing, you tell them that you're learning machine learning and then they'll of course be very happy and supportive. Now, another tool that you probably should experiment with if you haven't done so yet is Headless Chrome. What Headless Chrome refers to is basically using the Chrome browser engine without actually having a window open. This can be used to script various tasks. I have, for example, often used this to sort of take screenshots of websites in an automated fashion. But you can use this really to automate kind of any task against a web application. The advantage with Headless Chrome being is that, well, it is Chrome, so it really behaves like Chrome and can be difficult to detect for a website, whether or not you're using Headless Chrome or not. Well, there's now a nice blog post going over some of the ways how you are able to detect Headless Chrome. One thing is the user agent. There is this Headless Chrome string being added to it. Of course, that could easily be modified by someone, but then there are also specific JavaScript tricks and such to figure out that you are running Headless Chrome, which are more difficult to avoid by a possible attacker, for example, using Headless Chrome to launch an attack against your website. And then we got another tool that helps you with an attack that I mentioned multiple times in the last few weeks or months, and that's malicious visual code plugins. Amit SRF came up with a website they're calling ExtensionTotal and tries to mimic a little bit VirusTotal. That's also sort of where the name comes from, but is supposed to help you figure out if a particular extension is malicious or not. Interesting approach. Also does some sort of general tests on these extensions in real time. Take a look at it. See if you find it useful. Definitely sort of something that has some promise. And ASUS published firmware updates for a number of its routers. One of the critical vulnerabilities being addressed here is an authentication bypass issue. It does enable an attacker to log in without authentication as an administrator. I believe for these routers, this is actually the only account there is. And of course, once they are logged in, they have complete control over the device. There's a second vulnerability that's a buffer overflow, but it does require authentication in order to exploit it. So that one is definitely a lesser issue. And we don't really see a lot of these buffer overflows being exploited, probably because there are sufficient numbers of unpatched, simple web application vulnerabilities out there that may still be exploited first. Well, and this is it for today. Remember, there will be no podcast on Wednesday and Thursday, but talk to you again tomorrow. Bye.